All right, Stephen, I'm ready for you.
Well, welcome everyone. We're excited to have you here with us today. we are happy to offer this discussion and excited to share our recent report, Leading with Courage, Reshaping Southern Philanthropy for a New Era. This report is available for download on our website, and I'll put that link in the chat here in just a minute for everyone as a reminder. I'll provide a brief overview of the report to begin, as well as its key themes, and then we'll move into a discussion with our two members, Flozell and Corey, here today to speak to how these trends are more evident in their work and their foundation's work. You can go to the next slide. Before we get too far, though, I wanted to give a bit of a word about Philanthropy Southeast. Philanthropy Southeast was founded in 1969, so we've been around over 50 years now. We are based out of Atlanta. Most of our staff are based here where we are. We are the largest regional philanthropic support organization in the U.S., serving 11 states in the Southeast region. You can see our footprint here, plus the U.S. Caribbean territories. We are dedicated to strengthening Southern philanthropy, welcoming our members to listen, learn, and collaborate on ideas and actions to help build an equitable, prosperous South. So that's our mission. Go to the next slide. To give a little background on this report, last year we commissioned Peter Panapento and his team at Turn 2 Communications. He's a consultant that we've worked with often in the past, to produce a report exploring the key social, demographic, economic, and political factors influencing philanthropy. The report was intended to document how Southern foundations were evolving and adapting in response to these trends, especially in light of the events of 2020, the COVID-19 pandemic, and calls to advance racial equity in our work. We had been asked so many times about the things that our foundations were doing, and we were learning so much about the transformative work that they were doing in response to those events that we felt a need to collect, compile, and share that information more formally. So that was the genesis for this report. We relied heavily on our members to help inform the report and shape its direction. We led a number of different listening sessions with our board, our staff, our members, and Peter and his team conducted over 40 interviews with our members and other stakeholders around the region to help understand the trends and shape the report overall. From those interviews, from those listening sessions, we identified 7 key trends. You go to the next slide. And here you can see those 7 trends plus a set of emerging trends that are highlighted in brief in the report, and we expect to be brought more to the fore in the near future. But to give an overview of these trends just in brief, we looked at the demographic shifts that are influencing Southern communities and the philanthropic organizations that serve them, how Southern foundations are centering their work around advancing equity, how a new generation of leaders is bringing diverse perspectives and new ideas to traditional philanthropic organizations, the ways that foundations are working to bridge ever-deepening ideological divides in their communities, pioneering approaches to grant making and community leadership, the ways that foundations are and their work is evolving and adapting in response to all these different factors, emerging funding structures that are working alongside traditional philanthropy to approach social change in new and exciting ways, and how funders are working to ensure that rural communities receive due attention and resources. And then, of course, the emerging trends that I mentioned previously. Go to the next slide. And so here today to offer their perspectives and a little bit of background on their foundation's work in all of these areas in relation to these trends, we're excited to have both Reverend Corey Anderson and Flozell Daniels Jr. here to speak with you today. So Flozell, Corey, thank you so much for being here and offering your perspectives. I'm gonna jump right in. If folks have questions, please do feel free to offer those in the chat, and we'll try to leave some time towards the end. So be thinking about your own questions for the two, and let us know your thoughts on the report as well. Corey, I'm gonna offer the first question up to you. One of the more prominent trends we've seen in philanthropy over the last few years is a greater emphasis on advancing equity. whether that's through embedding equitable principles in foundations' internal practices, operations, or in their grant-making processes and giving priorities. Just to cite one thing from the report, we talk about how in our member survey, we found that half of our members have developed a greater, stronger focus on equity since 2020. And another third really had a really a long-lasting emphasis on equity. So a majority of our members in Philanthropy Southeast. Your foundation's current strategic plan explicitly focuses on advancing equity for all of those in your state. Can you share some background behind that focus, what that strategic planning process looked like at that time, and how those priorities are operationalized through Winthrop Rockefeller's work? And sure. I think, Akhila, we can probably bring down the slides too so we can see everybody.
Sure. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Stephen, for that question. So you're absolutely right. As I said at the beginning, our mission is a relentless pursuit. And I'll give you the long version, a relentless pursuit of economic equity, educational equity, social, ethnic, and racial equity for all Arkansans. And what we mean by that is, I try to illustrate it, is that we get to a place in Arkansas where when you disaggregate data by take your pick, race, place, gender, identity, all of those things. But when you disaggregate data by any or one of those things, that you can no longer tell who's who. That in essence, opportunities, challenges, outcomes, good, bad, and neutral are equitably distributed across all of the populations in Arkansas without respect to what your ethnicity is, what your gender is, whether you live in a rural or urban area, et cetera. That means that if you live in a little bitty town like Snow Lake, Arkansas, which is down in the Delta close to Louisiana, that you can get the same quality, high-speed broadband at an affordable price that I can get right here in Little Rock. That means that young African-American boys in the third grade are reading at the same level as maybe their higher income counterparts that are in the third grade. That means that women make the same fair wages or salaries as men. So when you think about all of those sort of graphs that maybe just popped up in your mind, think about all of those things being equitable, so equitably distributed. And the way that you get there is that you start in the places where the challenges are the deepest and where the neglect has been the longest and where the disinvestment has been the most egregious. And part of our theory is that if you solve the problem in the hardest places, then it gets easier everywhere else you go. So now that's a lot. And we are, like I said, we're our little bitty foundation. So like, how do we get there? We're a systems change organization. We believe that public policy and public systems create the outcomes that they're designed to create. So if, in fact, our education system is producing outcomes that are disparate across race and place and income, then those are the outcomes that that system is designed to create. And you have to change the system to change those outcomes. And how do you change systems, particularly public systems? You change those systems through public policy. How do you change public policy? You change the people that are making public policy. How do you change the people that are making public policy? You organize advocates and community leaders and the folks that, again, that are the most impacted to do that change. So I just described to you in fairly simple terms, something that's immensely complicated. And the truth of the matter is, I think what our board realized about, you know, I guess 5 years, 6 years ago at this point, what our board realized is that the way that we were doing philanthropy, and we think of ourselves as a really progressive foundation, and we think we have been for all 45 years of our existence. But even then, I think they realized that the way that we were doing our philanthropic work was not going to get us as quickly as we need to get to that systems change work. So they decided not just to change our mission, but to really change how we go about our work as a foundation. There are some things, I'll toss out some terms that I think most people are sort of engaged in now, But again, you know, 6 or 7 years ago, they were newer. It's, you know, it's trust-based philanthropy. It's core operating support. It's funding advocacy and organizing. And honestly, what those things represent, in my mind, is sort of philanthropy sort of shaking loose from the way that it was structured in the beginning by, you know, probably mostly well-meaning people, but by people that probably thought they knew better than the people that they were trying to help, and by people that thought they had the solutions that just needed to be implemented. So shaking loose from those structures and really creating an organization and ideally over time a field that values and centers the input of the populations that we say we're trying to impact, that values, and this is our version of it, right? That values this idea that we don't need to sort of tinker around the edges of these systems, that we actually really need to be dismantling and rebuilding those systems on behalf of serving those people. And by taking a hard look at ourselves as an organization for WRF, but as a field for philanthropy, and asking ourselves, you know, were we just doing sort of palliative care work? You know, were we just trying to make, you know, poverty more comfortable for folks? Or were we really trying to, for example, in Arkansas, are we really trying to change the economy so that 70% of our jobs actually pay a living wage versus the opposite, which is true now? So our board actually dug into those questions, you know, obviously changed our mission, and then began the process of changing us as a foundation. And I can talk a little bit about some of those other things as we get into the call.
Thank you so much, Corey. Flozell, Mary Reynolds Babcock has also stood out as a strong proponent of advancing equity in our region, but has seen some shifts recently to more support for power building and advocacy. Can you tell us about the foundation's history of work in this area, and what do you see as the current and future priorities in your foundation?
Yeah, thanks, Stephen. I just want to amen everything that the good Reverend mentioned by way of our understanding and co-learning in this work, and as much as we get to work across these 11 states in the region. You know, as I mentioned earlier, the Babcock Foundation for 70 years has been a leading force in Southern philanthropy, really trying to take cutting edge approaches that have pushed us to lean boldly into the work of being community-centered, adopting a risk-taking approach, fighting for everyone's full realization of democracy, and really trying to anchor every consideration, public-facing and internally, that we make in our commitment to equity. So the Babcock Foundation has always had conceptual values of equity, but I would say over the last 5 or 6 years, we started a much more intentional process and journey into clearly defining and committing to a building of power to advance racial equity approach in the American South, which really crystallized our learning and understanding of what we learned and what we've seen over the years, but also what we saw emerging in communities. These commitments are grounded by what we heard on the ground from our partners and what it will really take for the South to be a place where everyone thrives, as Corey mentioned, but particularly Black, Brown, and directly impacted folk and communities. So the board and staff has embarked on a journey of discovery and better understanding what this meant. We have done learning at the board and staff level, and we've made it a permanent part of our work as a deep equity learning organization to really push ourselves and to get the training to build the relationships and to be able to do that. And it's required us to examine our internal and external practices, making some hard decisions around our funding priorities, where we invest our endowment, and importantly, how we staff this work to respond to our goals and to be a good partner. And so we very much are leaning into this power building and advocacy and racial equity work at another level. I think over our 70 years, what we've seen is every 10 years or so, we do some deep learning. We come back having been taught by community how to improve ourselves so that we can be in service to community. And this latest iteration of the work is the current generation of that opportunity.
Follow-up question I was going to ask. Seeing as we've experienced some retrenchment in the field, there's some foundations who are pulling back on some of these commitments. And we've also seen that just in the broader, you know, society and political sphere as well. But what advice would you have for organizations that may be facing headwinds in advancing their equity work, or, you know, getting pushback in some way, whether it's internally from, say, board members or externally from these other factors? How would you, what advice would you have for your peers, or your colleagues out there?
Yeah, you know, if I could, you know, one of the things that's important and what I just mentioned is being a learning organization, paying attention to developing a practice of having an analysis of what's happening in the field and in community. And that happens through groups like Philanthropy Southeast, through GEO and other formations that we're a part of, and also connecting with our peer organizations, and I would say our aspirants, folks that we want to really step up to as far as our performance as organizations. It's really incumbent upon both staff and board to do the work of understanding where communities are and what's happening. It really means looking closely at ourselves and the role that philanthropy plays in these power dynamics, in addition to other relationships. The truth is, Stephen, many communities are under intentional attack. You talk about retrenchment, but there are also investments being made to purposely diminish the lives of people in communities and to weaken them and their families. And so we have a duty in philanthropy, I think, to really step into that gap and to be a good partner, to push our other philanthropic partners to reimagine and reconsider how they do their work, and to be more responsive to community. And this is not just a values-laden or values-based approach. It is also a data-informed and evidence-based approach. If we want our communities to be well, and everyone on this call has probably funded enough reports that give the ocular evidence, right, and the sort of data proof, we're going to have to fund in communities that have been divested from. We're going to have to move beyond our typical funding parameters and the way we assess and analyze whether organizations are ready to be funded. And we're going to have to lean into a racial equity analysis that may feel uncomfortable for some folks. I think the report that you all have put together really says very plainly that we need to include everyone in the progress of the American South. And funders are going to have to really pay attention to that. I think we have a duty as funders to lean in with our partner funders to push them a bit on the duty that they have at the board and staff level to have that analysis and for that to translate into their funding practices.
I'll switch just to add on to what Lozelle is saying. I'll switch hats, or I'll add my other hat. I'm chair of the board at AbbVie. And you know what Susan Batten and her team have been leading the field, along with other identity-based PSOs, HIP and APIP and the like, have said is to, you know, and this is the topic of the report, right? And I think the context as we're you know getting into the work of the report, this context emerges, you know, just as we're finishing the report, but. If leading with courage means anything in this moment, it is what Flozell said, right? And so what we're saying at AbbVie and other places is to keep doing the work, lean in. Obviously, we need in real practical ways, because we're entering into this era where the courts have created, you know, what is a, certainly a different context, right? Like we were. You know, we're used to people just sort of disagreeing around, you know, race and equity, right? But now you add this legal piece to the conversation. And I think to Flozell's point, I think what that means is that as in philanthropy as a field, is that we have to be willing and be leaders in adding the legal question to the work that we're doing also. So, you know, what sense would it make for us to allow our partners in Arkansas or in other places who are doing the necessary work that focuses on Black folks or Latino folks or women? What sense would it make for us to allow them to be victimized or attacked without providing the support and the resources to defend them? And what I've said in other places is honestly, and this is my boss, Charisse, Dr. Wes Scantlebury, talks all the time about the unnecessary attention that philanthropy pays to risk. If there's any field or if there's any group of organizations that ought to be willing to step out, because we are able, but that ought to be willing to step out and take some risk, it really is the field of philanthropy, because we are, for better, most of the times for worse, we are beholden, honestly, to no one but ourselves and our boards of directors. The IRS has got two or three things they want from us, but the rest of it is really up to us. This is one of those instances where, to Flozell's point, if somebody's going to take a hit around the things that we have all agreed are the correct things to do, then we ought to be, at the very least, creating the mechanisms to be ardent defenders. But at the most, maybe we ought to be stepping into the line of fire, so to speak, to try to take some of these hits early on. Again, we're in this court legal realm that's new to a lot of us, and so it is scary. But again, I think we're situated to address it much better than certainly our nonprofit partners from a resource perspective.
Mm-hmm. And Corey, I appreciate you bringing that up. One of the considerations we've had recently in finding some of our grantee partners are being put in the crosshairs in this legal attack, which is not new, actually, if you know this country's history. And so we're also doing the work of not only shifting resources to make sure they are well-resourced to be able to endure the fight, and checking in with groups like APFI and others who've actually done the work to help us understand this endangerment. But we're checking with our own lawyers at the foundation, knowing that we may get the letter in the mail. And it's not to serve any interest in us retrenching or shrinking. It's actually to make sure that we can grow and expand our voice from an equity and justice perspective for the purpose of showing up for our grantee partners and inside of the communities that we live in and love. So I really appreciate you bringing that up.
Thank you both. Flozell, I'm going to shift a bit to another trend that we talk about in the report. One of the factors driving a lot of these shifts in philanthropic priorities is a wave of leadership transitions that we've seen in the sector. In our member survey, we found that one in four of our member CEOs, or one in four of our member organizations, rather, had a transition in their CEO in the last, last 2 years, but 2 years between 2020 and 2022, plus another portion that said that they were probably going to be making a change in the near future. And we've seen that borne out in a lot of the updates that we've had from our members. You yourself, while you're not new to philanthropy, recently made a transition to Mary Reynolds Babcock from the Foundation for Louisiana. So I wanted to see if you could speak to your experience moving from one organization to the other, what that's been like for you personally, and what it's meant for your work now with Mary Reynolds Babcock. And what have you seen of maybe the broader trends in the sector with grantees as well?
Yeah, it's been great. I celebrated a year last week at the Babcock Foundation. I am still having a great time. And so that's good news. I got really lucky, Stephen. I got to into the Babcock process and there at a time when the board and staff with the search consultants really structured a very intentional hiring and onboarding process. As someone who'd been a philanthropic CEO for nearly 16 years now, it was notably well done. It was strategic. And most importantly, it was honest and transparent, right? This meant a lot to me as a professional, and also gave me confidence in the team and the board that I could continue to practice my own brand of equity-centered social justice philanthropic leadership, and also learn from, in this case, the Babcock team, and in a way that respects both my work experience as well as the wisdom derived from my lived experience and what that brings to the work, right? And I think this has set us up to do the work needed to continue to build trust with each other, sorting through how we collectively implement the work and wrestle with how we own our commitment to be a radically equitable funder, not only in our public facing work, but as well as our internal operations. And so it's really, I think, important to recognize that it's a true justice journey. And we talk about this a lot internally, and we're trying to normalize what that means. And we're doing the work to set ourselves up for success. And we're also recognizing one of our other values is transparency, really recognizing it's not always easy when you make these commitments and actually practicing them, implementing the work in a fulsome and honest way with some integrity, really requires us to not only be practically proficient in our jobs, grant makers, executives, finance folk, but it also requires us to grow ourselves as people who are committed to equity and to justice and the learning and the personal growth it takes. And we are on that journey. And I think the board and the team have done an outstanding job of setting us up to be able to practice. You know, you mentioned the field. I think it's been astonishing for me. And I don't know if it's COVID or if it's a cycle, but we've seen a lot of shifts in the field. And what's top of mind for me is this churn has not been particularly good for grantees. What I'm hearing in my role as chair of the Greater New Orleans Funders Network is, as well as someone who has a lot of colleagues in the field, we're concerned and really wanting to make sure that grantees and communities who are in deep relationship with their philanthropic partners aren't victims of this churn and of all the leadership changes. And we really want to see a couple of things. One is to make sure that boards and organizations are hiring people that are deeply connected to community and the work so that we can continue to make the progress that I think the field has been making. And we want to make sure that as these transitions happen, that we're encouraging folk to think deeply about their partners in the transition and to use, as Corey mentioned earlier, the full powers of philanthropy to stabilize and to make progress in our communities through these transitions. Unlike many sectors, we have the ability to move resources, both financial and technical support, that really help our grantee partners endure those transitions. And we see a real need for that to happen in the field as all of these transitions are happening.
Thank you, Flazel. Corey, you alluded earlier to systems change work and the importance of advocacy as part of that. Public policy has become a very contentious area within our sector as well as just more broadly. But as a statewide funder, Winthrop Rockefeller often has to bring together organizations and stakeholders from differing viewpoints to work towards a common goal. A good example would be education, where Winthrop Rockefeller is a key funder of initiatives such as Excel by 8 and Forward Arkansas. Can you share some of the foundation's approaches to that work, how you bring together people from different perspectives, different backgrounds on issues like education in the state?
Well, you know, the truth of it is, this is Philanthropy Southeast, so I will have much, I think, commiseration around the room. I can tell you how we used to do it when we were, you know, operating in a public policy environment that was just, you know, sort of here's our state level of disagreement on how we get to a high quality education system, right? It's just us in Arkansas. And here's the continuum of our level of disagreement on how you get there, right? So you mentioned Forward Arkansas. So probably 8 years ago now, we pulled together 30 people that were Republicans and Democrats and people that loved charter schools and people that hated charter schools, people from rural areas, from urban areas, policymakers, teachers, principals. There was a on this committee, We later learned one of the teachers was in an active lawsuit against one of the superintendents that was on the committee, right? We didn't learn that till later. We put them into a process, and over the course of about 9 months, they came up with a plan that was unanimously ratified. And we said it was purple. We talked to 6,000 people around the state. We went to 500 communities and put all of that together into a plan called Forward Arkansas. And then we partnered with the Walton Family Foundation to stand up a nonprofit that both of us made a 10-year commitment to take that plan and help make it real in the state, right? That was how we used to do it, because 8 years ago, when we talked about the level of disagreement on how you get somewhere, we were talking about this size continuum because it was just Arkansas. Today, the continuum of disagreement is this big because it's not just Arkansas that we're talking about. And again, I think the South in particular has been, you know, is more victim to this than certainly the Northwest or the Northeast. But now all of our states, many of our states in the South, are not only beholden to what we in the state think, but now we're beholden to what plays well in terms of national public policy and politics, right? So currently, what we're really thinking about is how do we recast an Arkansas-specific narrative that pulls that sort of continuum of disagreement back into a space where we can all operate together. And honestly, the ways that we're doing that are in how we think about using, give credit and kudos to the late Ambassador James Joseph, but using our SMURF, our social capital, our moral capital, our intellectual capital, our reputational capital, and our financial capital. And we are, I think, shifting, you know, fairly quickly, particularly around all three of those things, but around our financial capital into just different ways. Again, at the top, I ran through sort of our theory of change of how all of this works. So we're anticipating, our board is going into an assessment and a planning process next year, but we're anticipating, you know, talking to the board about things like how do we double down on our investments in advocacy and organizing. It may be even more importantly, how do we change the way that we invest in our nonprofit partners so that they're able to do the work? We have created and we're pitching developing a $50 million enterprise capital fund for Arkansas. And what that means is that as opposed to my state level advocacy partner saying to me, you know what, I need $300,000 to really do this work right. And I say back to them, that's great. Here's $100,000. Do your best, particularly in this context. Enterprise capital says, I'll be able to say with partners and with community members, you said you need $300,000. Here's $600,000. You know, use whatever you need for operating, and then drop the rest on your balance sheet. So that you've got the money to pivot, so that you've got the money to do the research, so that you've got the money, you know, to call in the Center on Budget and Policy priority when you need somebody to do, you know, to do 2 months worth of analysis in 2 days, because they've called a special legislative session and they're going to do away with personal income tax, right? That's really, I think, part of the answer, and it gets all the way back to this equity question and how philanthropy operates. We're trying to create an abundance mindset around these resources. That's not abundance without strategy, but it really is abundance with a focus on helping our partners, you know, not just be strong today, but be able to see around the corners that they really can't see around now because they don't have the opportunity because they're busy having to ask us for money or ask other people for money. So that was a long answer. The public policy question for us is really about narrative. We know Arkansans, and the questions and the conversations that we're having now, they're not really Arkansas conversations. We're trying to pull that back together so that we can have some Arkansas conversations. But at the same time, we want our advocacy and organizing partners in particular to have the resources they need to do the work that needs to be done so that the folks that don't want to have Arkansas conversations, they don't have to be at the State House if folks don't want them to be there.
That was great. And you mentioned SMURF and the different forms of philanthropic capital and the ways that you're working with grantee partners. I think that's a great lead into our next question. And I'll come back to you on this, Corey, but Flozell, moving over to you, we saw many funders adopt more flexible grant-making processes and requirements in the immediate response to the COVID-19 pandemic. Marie Reynolds Babcock served as a prime example by increasing their payout to existing grantees, lifting restrictions on how grant funds could be used, and focusing on support for grassroots networks around the region. What has the foundation learned from that experience? And what recommendations would you have for other funders who may be exploring how to build more transparency, more flexibility into their own grant-making processes?
Yeah, it's a great question, Stephen. So a few things that we learned in the process, and you all know, like most of the folks on this call, there was a tremendous effort made by the team and the board to come together quickly and make adjustments. At the time, I was on the other side of the table as a grantee partner of the Babcock Foundation, so I had firsthand experience in the power of them moving so quickly and so strategically. And what we heard from people was deep gratitude for not only having flexible resources, but the ability to use them to support strategies that they needed to pivot, but also to continue to support people and communities during the pandemic and beyond. And in particular, people wanted to sustain their strategic work while they were managing the crisis moment, right? And having those flexible dollars and strategies and approaches meant a lot. And grantees shared that by making bold steps, it helped other funders see the ability for them to pull off restrictions and respond to the moment with deep compassion in a way that centered communities. And so Babcock ended up attracting other dollars into Southern communities from some national funders who were interested in partnering in that way. And we think that's a huge learning for us. One of the big takeaways that we have is if we can pull off the restrictions, make payments up front, take away the reporting requirements, it really leads us into understanding what permanent practice can look like. We can continue to lean more deeply into trusting our grantees and understanding that our relationships with folks on the ground is what allowed us to move so quickly. And so during the pandemic, just to be certain, we within 30 days of shutting down, we issued $10,000 grants to all grantees to support whatever they needed, paid out all grants, and added an additional year of general operating support to current grantees without additional documentation. That included releasing all reporting requirements and removing all grant restrictions. We suspended spending ceilings to be able to respond quickly to grantee partner needs and provided crisis response support throughout the year through quick grants of up to $20,000, according to how things were evolving and as we heard more from grantee partners. And we shifted site visits so that we could minimize impact on communities so we could take calls or Zooms or whatever worked for folks. In addition to our grant making, some of you may know we have a $10 million program-related investment fund, and we eliminated the interest on those PRIs to free up cash and converted 20% of those investments in CDFI loan funds into grants to provide additional operating support and strengthen balance sheets for those CDFIs. It goes to Corey's point about with philanthropy, we get to make decisions and shift and do things that actually move the work. And extended the maturity of many of those PRIs, all of them actually an additional year. And it really gave us space to increase the organizational development investments. And, you know, by way of recommendations, we are hoping that our partner funders step back and look at what's been done to support grantees during the pandemic and figure out what you can continue to do in that context and really ask yourself about why we're asking for all the information, what is the purpose? I mean, to be fully honest, in some cases we found we were receiving reports for which we had no use for that information. We weren't actually using it. And so the team just pivoted. And now we are in deeper relationship. We have conversations. We get feedback. We write those reports up internally and check in with grantee partners about the process. Ask for their feedback and make sure that the assumptions that we're making are in alignment with their experience, because as we know, the experience evolves over time.
Stephen, I know you're asking the questions, but just for the record and for the purposes of this recording, let me ask Flozell. Flozell, you all did all of those things. Yeah. And yet here you are today as a vibrant, future-leaning, future-looking, high-functioning philanthropic organization. You all are still standing. Is that correct? They put you out of business. Nobody got fired, right?
At the risk of sounding hyperbolic, Corey, we're not only still standing, we're better, we're stronger, we know more, we have a better connection and relationship, our grantee partners are stronger, they're more knowledgeable, they've been able to move their work, they've been able to take care of themselves. I think the Women's Foundation for the South is on here. Folks have resources to engage in self-care and the healing that will sustain them in the work. Oh yeah, we are, as you can tell, big fans and advocates of making these kinds of shifts. And it has only improved our work and improved our practice and sustainability. Because as it turns out, the people on our side of the table are also humans with families and want to be able to sustain themselves in the work also.
Amen to all that. Thank you. Appreciate that. I want to go through one more trend or highlight one more trend, and then we'll open it up for some other questions. But Corey, this is coming back to you, thinking about how much funding goes into rural communities, or I should say lack of funding going into rural communities. Our report, we also kind of mentioned a reference report by the USDA, their Economic Bureau, that found, although 1 in 5 Americans live in rural communities, only 1 in 20 philanthropic dollars flows into those same areas. Winthrop Rockefeller, being a state funder, you know, works to improve the lives of all Arkansans. How does the foundation ensure that rural communities in the state receive adequate levels of support and funding, same in different areas of the state?
Yeah, so in a real practical way, again, if I go back to sort of the equity as a framework for action definition, we realize that, again, if we're solving problems, we got to solve them in the places where they're most difficult to solve first, right? And I say that if we're contributing to the solutions for those areas, we're not solving them ourselves. So we have a bias towards rural. Really, if you look at our funding, probably the very vast majority of it goes to rural areas. If folks know Arkansas, Northwest Arkansas is technically a rural area, but it's a bit of a different type of area with the big Fortune 500 companies that it's got located up there. So we spend a lot of our time focusing on the Delta of Arkansas. And again, we're a small foundation, right? We're doing $5 or $6 million worth of grant making in a good year. So most of what we're trying to do is create opportunities to leverage what we have. So for example, really over the last 2 years and into the next year, what we've committed a lot of our time to doing is making sure that rural Arkansas, in particular the Delta, gets an opportunity to try for every penny of federal infrastructure money that there is out there that's available to those communities. Billions of dollars that can go towards just about any and everything. And so, for example, we've got a consultant corps that's out in the Delta that's just almost available for really anybody to call and say, hey, I need a new fire station. I know somebody's got money for fire stations. Can you help me? And our consultant corps is going to make those connections. We invested, for another example, we invested about $100,000 in consultants to connect with the USDA on flood abatement work, on money to create levees and flood abatement infrastructure in the Delta. That $100,000 investment netted $100 million from the USDA that's going to 10 communities, all in the Delta, actually all by happenstance almost, led by Black mayors. So honestly, in this current sort of context, that's really what we're doing, is trying to make sure we're standing in the gap, particularly around federal resources, again, particularly in places where the state expressions of those federal agencies haven't done a good job in the past of making sure those resources were available to those communities. So that's the current context that we're really working in, is really focusing on those federal dollars, because those are going to go away here soon, and we don't want to miss out on all of it. So.
And Lozell Babcock has been one of the only true regional funders in the Southeast. Not only does the foundation fund across numerous states, but has often prioritized support for rural underserved areas. You mentioned your PRIs that often target economic mobility in underserved communities across the region. I'm wondering if you can share more about the foundation's work and impact in rural communities.
Yeah, you know, it's been nearly 20 years, and we've been able to, we initially stepped into the space because access to banking and financial services for low-wealth communities across the region, particularly in rural places, was very limited, in some cases non-existent. We saw it as a way for folks in place to access greater economic opportunity. And we did this by providing below-market investments, but also grants to support the organization as a whole. What we were trying to do was actually be a part of the movement to build a field of CDFIs and other financial serving organizations as a crucial part of our commitment to racial equity across regions. And so this means, you know, places like South Carolina, for instance, have access to strong loan funds that are developing affordable housing, supporting small business incubation. We've supported a series of grantees who've helped to advocate for a housing trust fund at the state level, and supported organizations to help communities through heirs property rights, which we all know is a huge issue in the South, that would allow them to use the land that's there to develop new business opportunities. And it showed up in Appalachia and some of that work to transition from a coal economy to a more just economy, with microloans and business development and supporting the mission critical intermediary organizations that are helping to revitalize those communities. And we've really started in this iteration of our work to ask ourselves, how do we deepen this work and take the lessons we've learned to build long-term power with community and to really reimagine our understanding of economic power as a larger power building frame and its impact on racial equity. And, you know, it's important to recognize that we created sort of this state level approach where we mostly fund leaders and formations at the state level to impact state policy on purpose, because we understand that people don't just live in their communities, urban or rural, people tend to live across regions. And so a lot of our work to support state tables and policy advocacy and organizing supports really does benefit rural communities with intention, and the all too important work of the regional work that allows us to elevate folks where, or to support folks elevating themselves as much as possible. The last thing I'll mention that I think is a really important part of this work now and going forward is our Democracy Protection Fund. We have an intentional programmatic thrust on working with groups that are working on voting rights, access to the franchise, protecting democracy, dealing with these legal issues that Corey talked about, and all of that stuff. And that's been an important part of our rural communities work, because the field forgets, in the context of the political dynamic, there are significant Black and Brown communities in rural places and spaces. And we want to make sure that we're having some integrity in the process.
Well, this has been terrific. I want to thank you both. We're getting close to our time, so I've got a couple questions that came in via chat, and I'm going to borrow one and offer this as a opportunity for some closing comments. But maybe for each of you, what is one thing that you're hopeful about coming out of this report, coming out of this discussion, and that you want to share with the attendees?
Sure. That the moment that we're operating in is a moment for philanthropy to lean in, make some really substantive changes in the way that the field operates, and then institutionalize those changes. Maybe that's the short way to talk about it.
Yeah. You know, I've been thinking when I first saw the report, one of my favorite virtues, values, words is courage. And many people have talked about it. I think our good sister, Mama Maya Angelou, said it best though when she, I'm paraphrasing here, but she said, you cannot practice any of the other virtues consistently without practicing courage first. And there is an opportunity for us as funders, as partners, as neighbors of people across the American South to summon and to practice our courage. We are in a very important moment in history, and philanthropy should stand up inside of that moment with courage to be able to shift our practices and to show up for the folks who we say we love in this context, and to accommodate the changes necessary to be able to do so.
Lozelle, Corey, again, I want to thank you so much for offering your thoughts and your experiences, your perspectives with us today. Akilah, thank you as well for organizing this conversation for us and hosting. And thank you everyone for joining us for this conversation. We hope this has been informative and inspiring for you. And we encourage you to download the report again from our website at philanthropysoutheast.org. And please hopefully keep this conversation going in your own organization. So thank you.
Thank you all. Take care, everybody.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. We'll share the recording soon. Have a great day.
Looking forward
to it. Thank you.
Thanks, fans.
All right.
Thank you, Gary.
Bye.
Are you you stopping the recording?
I think so.